Hello, B here, and welcome back to Integrated Physics and Chemistry. Have you ever seen one of those bags of frozen mixed vegetables? You know, the kind with peas, corn, and diced carrots? Let's imagine you close your eyes and reach into the bag and grab a handful of veggies. When you put it in the bowl, there will be a combo of all three. Corn, peas, and diced carrots are all close to the same mass, but not identical. However, if you had 20 pieces and divided the total mass by 20, you would get a close approximation of the mass of a single pea, corn, or diced carrot in the bag, right? Well, that is sort of how atoms work. Each sample of an element has a mix of different versions of the same element, usually just two or three versions, each with a different mass. Atoms of the same element that have a different mass are called isotopes. But before we get started, let's look at our goals for this lesson. By the end, you'll be able to define isotopes, explain atomic mass and compare it to mass number, use an element's atomic mass to discuss the subatomic particles present in the element. If you remember back to our previous lesson discussing the structure of the atom, you will remember that the number of protons present in an atom determines the identity of that atom. And this number, the atomic number, is the whole number found on the periodic table. For example, carbon has an atomic number of 6. This means that every atom of carbon has 6 protons. If you change the number of protons, you change the element. If you somehow added a proton to a carbon atom, you no longer have carbon. You have nitrogen with an atomic number of 7. What about the neutrons? We also learned in that same lesson that atoms of the same element can have a different number of neutrons. These variations of elements are called isotopes. Isotopes are two or more atoms of the same element with a different mass. The only way to change the mass of an atom and have it remain the same element is to change the number of neutrons. This is because only protons and neutrons contribute to the mass of an atom, since electrons are too small to count. And changing the number of protons changes the identity of the atom. Sometimes when discussing an element, it is important to be specific about which isotope you are talking about. This is because most elements have two or three different naturally occurring isotopes. Carbon, for example, has 3 isotopes: carbon-12, carbon-13, and carbon-14. The number in the name, 12, 13, or 14, refers to the mass of that particular isotope. So carbon-12 has 6 protons and 6 neutrons, because 6 plus 6 equals 12. Carbon-13 has 6 protons and 7 neutrons, because 6 plus 7 equals 13. How many neutrons does carbon-14 have? 8, because 6 plus 18 equals 14. Have you ever heard of radioactive decay? This is when an atom is unstable and must lose a subatomic particle from its nucleus in order to become stable. Even though an element can have multiple isotopes, often at least one, if not more, of those isotopes are radioactive or unstable. In the case of carbon, the isotope with a mass of 14 is unstable. It has too many neutrons and is too heavy to stay together. In fact, scientists use the presence of this specific unstable isotope for a process called carbon dating, which they use to date fossils. Let's go back to the example at the start of this lesson, the one with the frozen veggies. If you knew that the bag had exactly 100 of each veggie, and you also knew that the mass of the diced carrot is 1 gram, the mass of the pea is 0.75 gram, and the mass of the corn is 0.5 gram, you could calculate the average mass of a single piece of vegetable in the bag. To do this, you would multiply the mass of carrots, 1 gram, times 100 to get 100 grams. The mass of peas, 0.75 gram times 100 to get 75 grams, and the mass of the corn, 0.5 gram times 100 to get 50 grams. Then you add all three of these masses together, 100 plus 75 plus 50 to get 225, and divide by the total number of veggies in the bag, 300. 225 divided by 300 is equal to 0.75, so the average mass of a single piece of vegetable in the bag is 0.75 gram. What would happen to the average mass of a veggie in the bag if, instead of an equal amount of each type of vegetable, you had 200 carrots, 50 peas, and 50 corn kernels? Let's calculate the mass to find out. If we multiply the mass of carrots, 1 gram, times the number of carrots, 200, we get 200 grams. If we multiply the mass of peas, 0.75 gram, times the number of peas, 50, we get 37.5 grams. And if we multiply the mass of corn, 0.5 gram, times the number of corn kernels, we get 25 grams. Adding them together, we get 200 plus 37.5 plus 25 grams for a total of 262.5 grams. Divide the total mass by 300 for the total number of pieces of vegetables in the bag, and we get an average mass of 0.87 gram. Why is this average mass higher than the original average mass we calculated when there was an equal number of each vegetable in the bag? The average mass was higher because there were a lot more carrots, which have a higher mass than the corn and the peas. This skewed the mass toward the mass of the carrots. This type of average, where the abundance of a variation of an item is taken into account, is called the weighted average. The atomic mass of an element is a weighted average of all of the isotopes of the element. A weighted average is more than a simple average of all of the weights. You must also take into account how abundant each isotope is in nature. Let's look at nitrogen, for example. Nitrogen has three isotopes: nitrogen 14, nitrogen 15, and nitrogen 16. However, nitrogen 14 is the most abundant, accounting for 99.63% of all atoms of nitrogen. That means that out of every 100 atoms of nitrogen, over 99 of them have a mass of 14. When calculating a weighted average of these three masses, it will be heavily skewed toward the mass of 14. And in fact, the average atomic mass of nitrogen is 14.007 amu. Another way that weighted atomic masses can come in handy is when trying to determine the number of neutrons in an element. If you do not have a mass number for an atom, you can use the atomic mass to determine the mass of the most common isotope of an element by rounding the atomic mass to the nearest whole number. Looking at nitrogen again, if we round the atomic mass, 14.007, to the nearest whole number, 14, we can assume that the most common isotope of nitrogen is nitrogen 14, which is true. Let's look at one more example together. Looking at the periodic table, can you find phosphorus with the symbol of capital P? Let's zoom in on the box for phosphorus. What is the atomic number for phosphorus? It's 15. Knowing the atomic number also means we know the number of protons, which is also 15. There is another number in the box, the atomic mass. If we want to know the most common isotope of phosphorus, we can round the atomic mass to the nearest whole number. In this case, 30.9 AMU rounds to 31 AMU. We can assume that the most common isotope of phosphorus is phosphorus 31. If the mass number of this isotope is 31, and all atoms of phosphorus have 15 protons, how many neutrons does this isotope have? 31 minus 15 equals 16, so it has 16 neutrons. But it is important to remember that this is just the number of neutrons in the most commonly found isotope of phosphorus. There are other isotopes of phosphorus in nature that have fewer than 16 neutrons, which explains why the atomic mass is slightly less than 31. As we went through the lesson today, we defined isotopes and looked at how isotopes are connected to an element's atomic mass. Next lesson, we will begin exploring the periodic table and how scientists have organized the elements in a clear and concise table used all around the world. Until next time, remember that the universe is vast and full of surprises, so never stop exploring. Hey, hey.